The Gospel according to John, the 20th chapter. I want you to look with me to verse 19. And we're going to read a rather lengthy passage here. In fact, we're going to read from verse 29, or rather verse 19 down through 29. Why don't you just stand with me and let's read this responsively. I'm going to read verse 19, and I want you to read verse 20, and we'll alternate until we get to verse 29, which we will read all together. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. Then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you.
And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost.
Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them, and whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. Then saith he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing.
And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God.
Together Jesus saith unto them, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen. All right, may the Lord add a blessing to the readers and hearers of his word. And in verse 29, Jesus brought us into the number. Because thou hast seen, Thomas, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. Thank God I'm in the blessed crowd. Can you say that? Thank God.
Thank God.
I'm in the blessed crowd. That's why we're here today. Because we are part of the blessed crowd. As we began reading with verse 19, it says the same day. The same day. If you would go all the way back, and you might do this when you get home, and read from verse 1 of chapter 20, you will find that this is the evening of the same day in which our Lord was resurrected. It had only been 3 days when it seems as though their whole world had collapsed. These men of Israel had started following Jesus some 3.5 years prior to this date. They did not fully understand what his message and mission was. And it is true that even now some people join churches and become members of various movements that they don't really understand. Jesus had enlisted, he had recruited a group of followers, men of Israel, who were tired of the feet of Gentiles trotting up and down in their holy city. They had remembered through history the great days of the kingdom of Israel that had reached its zenith under King David and his son Solomon. Following the reign of Solomon, the kingdom split on Solomon's son Rehoboam. Later, the northern kingdom went into captivity under the might of Assyria. The southern kingdom of Judah came under the tyranny of the Babylonian Empire. From that time until the coming of Jesus Christ, Israel did not have control of her own destiny, but had to look to these pagans who did not believe in Yahweh, did not believe in Jehovah, the God of Israel, and did not look for a promised Messiah. They understood that a Messiah would come, but they did not think of him in terms of him being a holy man. They thought of him being a warring king such as David. And while Barabbas and other insurrectionists were gathering their guerrilla armies, working toward the overthrow of the Roman government, these men saw Jesus somewhat as a magician who was able to cure diseases, to walk on water, and to do so many things that could not be explained in the realm of purely human thought. When Jesus talked to them concerning his going up to Jerusalem and there he would be delivered into the hands of the Gentiles, and there he would be crucified and would die, and then 3 days later would rise again, they felt that they were hearing the ravings of a madman. They had seen him raise others from the dead, but how could he raise himself when he could not even bring himself off of a cruel cross? They saw the Roman soldiers arrest him in the Garden of Gethsemane, and they waited for him to give the word so that they could rise up, and hoping that maybe with the superhuman strength of a Samson, that the 12 of them would be able to overthrow that particular detachment of a Roman army. But Jesus only gave a slight demonstration of his power when he asked, "Whom seek ye?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." And Jesus spoke and said, "I am he." And with the power of heaven in his voice, they fell like dead men. And then he asked them again in his human voice, "Whom do you seek?" They said, "Jesus of Nazareth." And he said, "I am he." He recognized the scripture said, "Thou shalt smite the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered." So he said, "Let these go free. I'll go with you." And they carried him into the judgment hall of Caiaphas, the high priest. And Caiaphas examined him. One of the soldiers struck him in his face. Caiaphas said, "The man is guilty of blasphemy, and I'm going to send him to Pilate, because only Pilate has the power to execute one who is guilty of treason. Pilate questioned him for a few moments, and his wife sent a message in saying, "Have nothing to do with this just man, for I've suffered many things because of him in a dream." And when he heard that Herod was in town for the feast, said, "Well, he's really from Galilee, so send him to Herod." And Herod, a robed idiot occupying the throne of a king, tried to make Jesus work some kind of a miracle. "Show me a miracle." And Jesus stood before him and said nothing. And when Herod saw that he could not get him to do anything, he said, "Send him back to Pilate." Pilate tried to prevail upon the crowd. "Let him go. I find no fault in the man." And they said, "We have a law, and if you release him, you are not Caesar's friends." So Pilate did what a lot of people try to do today. He washed his hands and said, "I'm clear of this man's blood." But not before he said to Jesus, "I've got the power to put you to death, and I've got the power to release you." And Jesus said to Pilate, as he says to every government leader in the universe, "You will have no power at all except it be given thee from above." And when he asked them, "Who do you prefer?" It's a custom to release a prisoner at your feast day. "I have an insurrectionist here. I have a murderer here. I have a malefactor here by the name of Barabbas. I can crucify him. That'll satisfy your craving for blood, and we can let this man Jesus go free." They said, "No, no, no. Release Barabbas and crucify Jesus." And Jesus was turned over to be crucified. And at this point, the hope that was in his disciples died. For as we go to the cross, to Calvary, there is only one disciple present. The others have fled, and nobody stands at the foot of the cross but John. John, the writer of the Gospel of John. John, the writer of the first, second, and third epistle of John. John, the beloved disciple that laid his head over on Jesus' breast the night in which he was betrayed and asked him, "Master, who is it that betrayeth thee?" John is standing there with three Marys. And I ask each one of the Marys, "What are you doing here?" "Well, Mary number one, what are you doing here?" She said, "I'm the mother of Jesus, and I just want to be with my son." I asked the other Mary, "What are you doing here?" She said, "Well, I am the wife of Cleophas, and I'm a good friend of this Mary, and I'm here to be with my friend." And I asked the third Mary, "What are you doing here?" She said, "They call me Magdalene. He cast seven devils out of me, and I'm just here because I love him." But all of the disciples are behind closed doors. Nobody is there but John. And Jesus speaks from the cross and says, "Woman, behold thy son." And then he turns his eyes to John and said, "Son, behold thy mother." And he gave his mother to John that John might look after her. But the other disciples can't be found. They're all hiding behind closed doors for fear. And after Jesus died and hung his head in the lock of his shoulder, John has been charged by Jesus, "Take care of my mother." Judas is the one that betrayed him, and by now he's committed suicide. And the other 10 can't be found. So the secret disciples had to come out of hiding. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, and they went to Pilate and begged for the body of Jesus. And they did a quick anointing of his body with a solution of myrrh and aloes, wrapped his body in grave clothes, put him into Joseph's new tomb. And as I've said so many times, Joseph must have had an inkling that Jesus wouldn't need the tomb for eternity, so he let him borrow it for the weekend. Put him into the tomb, and the other disciples are behind closed doors for fear. And yet, somehow, the soldiers of Pilate, the soldiers of Caiaphas the high priest, the enemies of Christ, they expected the resurrection, but his friends did not. His brethren had scattered. But I hear those temple guards going to Pilate and saying, remember this deceiver said, destroy this temple and in 3 days I'll raise it up again. And if something happened that we can't explain, the worst, the last error will be worse than the first. Pilate said, well, you have your gods. You go ahead on and make the watch as sure as you can. And he said, the only thing that I'll do is give a government seal. So they got a big, huge stone, and they put it up to the entrance of that tomb. And they put a government seal, daring anybody to break the seal, because if you do so, you'll break the law. Who have ever seen such a ridiculous spectacle? Armed guards standing outside a tomb to keep the dead on the inside from rising. A government seal to say if you get up and come out, you're breaking the law. But somehow his enemies knew something would happen. But his disciples were behind closed doors for fear. But right on God's schedule, early in the morning, while everybody else was asleep, while the guards were nervously pacing up and down, God dispatched an angel. He doesn't even tell us the angel's name, but he came from the shining halls of glory, and with one swish, he rolled the stone away. And the government seal was broken. And our Lord stepped out. Hallelujah. And when he walked out, the keepers started trembling and falling like dead men. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. And when they started running the town to say, hey, he did it, he did it, he did it. He got up. Wait, shut up. What you talking about? He came out of the tomb. And they came up with some money and said, hey, now, you fellas, don't tell that. Don't tell that. Tell them that while you all were asleep, that his disciples stole his body. But look, we can't do that, because if we let a prisoner escape, then we are in danger of being killed. So that's all right, we'll cover you. You tell the lie, and then we'll cover you, and you won't have to be tried for it. And they told the lie that he didn't rise, but that he was stolen away. But oh, I want you to know that if they had stolen his body, a dead Jesus couldn't have changed my life. A dead Jesus couldn't deliver drug addicts. A dead Jesus couldn't have changed us and lifted us out of the gutter of sin, degradation, and despair. And I don't care what anybody says, I serve a risen Savior. He's in this world this day. I know he's living. No matter what men say, I feel his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And every time I need him, he's always near. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. Walks with me, talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives. Salvation he imparts. You ask me how I know he lives? He lives. He lives in my heart. Lord, I'm trying to keep this down, but I feel something. When I start talking about it, he comes alive in my spirit. The women, sit down for a moment. The women started running to tell the news. He's alive. And you know, brothers, how it is. We don't want to believe it sometimes just because it came from a woman. He's alive. They said the women came up with a strange tale talking about he's alive. And here they are hiding behind closed doors for fear. And since they wouldn't believe the women, hallelujah, Jesus knew where the brothers were hiding out. And now he had his glorified body. And the door was shut. The door was locked and bolted. And I don't know how he did it, but all of a sudden he just stepped in where they were. Hallelujah. And everybody was there except Judas, who had killed himself. And Thomas, who just decided, I won't go to church today. You ought to touch somebody and tell them it's bad to miss church. Because you understand what the Lord might decide to do when you are not there. When folk try to explain it to you, you won't even want to believe it. Everybody was there but Thomas. But Thomas, who is called Didymus, he didn't show up. And they went and told him, said, Thomas, you can't imagine what happened. Thomas still got his head down. They crucified our Lord. All of our hopes are gone. We thought he was the one that was going to redeem Israel. We thought he was the one that was going to overthrow Rome. But oh, he's dead. But Thomas, we're trying to tell you, he's alive. What you mean he's alive? We just left the meeting place. And while we were meeting, Jesus came in. Quit trying. Y'all done made up a story. Y'all done got together on this lie while I wasn't there. I don't believe it. In fact, I tell you, I won't believe it unless I can take my finger, put it in the holes of the nails in his hand. And I know I wasn't close, but I was far enough away, but yet far enough to be safe, but close enough to see. And from where I was up in the hills, I saw that big old spear that they put in his side. And I could put my whole hand in his side. And unless I put my finger in the nail prints of his hand and put my hand in his side, I won't believe. And one thing I love about Jesus, you can't force him to do nothing. Jesus waited a whole 8 days. He let Thomas go doubting and bluffing for a whole 8 days. But 8 days later, when they were meeting again in the same room, the doors were shut, and all of a sudden, Jesus stepped in and said, Thomas, come here, Thomas. He said, now, here's my hand, here's my side. And Thomas did just what Buckley's doing. Thomas didn't touch nothing. All he had to do was see. And when he saw it, he believed. But I hear Jesus saying, now, Thomas, you believe because you've seen. But oh, I got a crowd that haven't seen me. Oh, I got a crowd. They haven't felt me. But oh, they believe it. And I'm glad I'm in that crowd. I wasn't here 2,000 years ago when he was hung up for my hang-up. I wasn't here when they buried him in Joseph's new tomb. I wasn't here when he walked out saying, oh, heaven and earth is in my hand. I wasn't here when he caught the cloud and went back home. But I believe. I believe. Hallelujah. Lord, let me quit. Whole lot of folks talking about seeing is believing. But this thing works the other way. Tell somebody, if you believe now, you can see later. Oh! If you believe it now, you don't have to worry. Seeing time is coming after a while. Oh, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him. And even those that crucified him, the Bible said they shall look on him whom they have pierced. I haven't seen him, but faith tells me it's a reality. Faith tells me that it happened just like the Bible said. And oh, one day I'm gonna see him. And when I see him, won't nobody have to introduce me to him. But oh, I shall know him. As redeemed by his side I stand. Oh, I shall know him by the prints of the nails in his hand. Oh, I shall know him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sit down, y'all. I'm going to quit. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, sit down, y'all. Sit down, sit down. I'm not here just because this is what the world calls Easter Sunday. I'm not here just because this is Resurrection Sunday. Huh? But I'm here because he's alive and because he's living down in me. Bishop Reed, I believe it because it's written in the book. But not only do I believe it because it's in the book, I believe it because he's living in me. Things I used to do, I don't do no more. Places I used to go, I don't go no more. Desires I used to have, I don't have no more. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. God bless you. God bless you. I want to take this opportunity to give somebody a chance to come to Jesus. Oh, bless his name. I said this morning at the 7:45 worship at our other location that from Genesis to Revelation, and this is a day when there's a great hunger. Everybody wants to know more about God's word. But if every other story in the Bible, if they took out the story of Elijah, hallelujah, going to heaven on the chariot, if they took out the story of Elisha making iron swim, if they took out the story of Moses dividing the Red Sea, if they took out every story in the Bible, this one is the heart of our Christian experience. As you read the New Testament, you will find that this one bit of information was what caused the Greco-Roman world 2,000 years ago to be stood on its head. They weren't concerned that much about Jesus causing lame folk to walk, blind eyes to see. But in that third chapter of the Acts of the Apostles, when Peter and John went up to the temple at the ninth hour, being the hour of prayer, and said to that lame man at the beautiful gate, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Caught him by the hand, and immediately he received strength in his leg and in his ankle bone. And he leaped up, entered into the temple, was in the temple walking and leaping and praising God. And when Peter and John came in, the people start bowing in the temple before them, named them some Greek god's names. And they said, no, don't look on us, It's not by our power or holiness that this man is made to walk, but Jesus Christ, whom you crucified, him God raised up. And whenever that phrase was mentioned, get ready for trouble, because the rest of what you read in chapter 3 and 4, the scribes, the Pharisees, and the Sadducees got upset because they started preaching the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Go to Mars Hill with Paul, and there in that 17th chapter, when he comes to Areopagus there in Athens and tell him, you of all men, you're too superstitious. I passed by and beheld your devotions, and I saw an altar written with an inscription to the unknown God, him that you ignorantly worship, him declare I unto thee. It's in him that you live and move and have your being. And he goes on to tell the story of God raising up Jesus, and they made one point, said, listen, we'll have to hear you later, after he talked about the resurrection. The one point that the world can't understand, because this world has a concept that when you're dead, you're done. But Christianity is different from any other religion, because Jesus said, if you come unto me, I'll not only be your leader and your teacher and your Lord and your guide for time, but I'll be your God throughout eternity. And you can live with me always. And if you take this out of Christianity, there is no Christianity. You may as well go on to the Buddhist temple and sit down and gaze at a bowl of fruit all day. You may as well come up with your own mind science, because what makes us different is because our Lord conquered death. And he said, the same power that I have, I've given that power to you. And even when they roll your body down the aisle in a casket, that's only the house where you used to live. And Paul said, we don't even die like other folk. He said, I'm at home in the body, but while I'm home in the body, I'm absent from the Lord. And I'd rather be absent from the body, because when I'm absent from the body, I'm present with the Lord. When I was a little boy, I thought that folk died, and when they died, they had to just wait there throughout all the centuries and all eternity, know nothing, be nothing, go back to dust, and that was all of me. But I found out that the body is only one third of my tripartite being, and that when that body goes back to the dust, the real me haven't died, the real me just moved out. And when you go back and hear Jesus at the cross, you find out that that's really what happened. They're waiting for the body to die. But before he gave them the body to be buried, he said, Father, into thine hands I commend my spirit. And he blew his own lights out. And while the body was resting in Joseph's new tomb, the spirit that he put in the hands of the Father, according to Peter, that spirit went back into the antediluvian world and must have entered into a time tunnel and kicked out the backside of the grave. And he was preaching the spirits in prison. Y'all don't hear me. And I know he had to be doing something more than sleeping, because he took the sting out of death, robbed the grave of his victory, and came out dangling some keys. So death don't have power over nothing but this body. The real me, the spirit man that lives on the inside, the very minute before the doctor can say, well, he's gone. If he could hear me speak in the spirit, I'd say, hey, fella, I left so many minutes ago. Then gone. And right now, in the presence of my Lord, that's what makes us different. We march to the beat of another drum. And you that put all of your hope in this, honey, you don't know who you are. The real you is the one that's living down on the inside. I want every sinner in this building, don't put it off another day. You've already put it off too long. It's time for you to give your life to Jesus. Backslider that have known the Lord and you strayed away, but today, down on the inside, you hear the call of the Lord telling you to come on back home. And then those of you that's already saved, but you know this is where God wants you to be, and you want to make this your church home, the door of the church is open. If you're in the balcony, get up, go to the elevator, push one, come on down. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my brother. If you're in the west wing, out here in front of me, get up and come to the nearest aisle. The Lord is calling you. God bless you, my sister. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and give God praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, bless his name. That's right, saints, give God praise. Oh, hallelujah. We offer Christ to you. Oh, my brother. We offer Christ to you. Oh, my sister. Hallelujah. Well, there are yet eight more. The Lord spoke 25 to my spirit. And I know there are eight more of you that the Lord's speaking to. Come on. Get up. Don't wait on nobody else. It's your time. If you're lost in sin, he'll save you. Backslider, he'll reclaim you. That's right, young man. Come on. Hallelujah. Not yet waiting on others from the balcony. There's something more that the Lord is speaking to. Get on up. Come on. got about another 90 seconds. You know, the enemy can defeat you. You don't have to say, no, I don't want to receive the Lord. All you need to do is keep procrastinating. All you have to do is keep on delaying. See, the enemy sees something in front of you that you don't see. You don't know when your appointment is with death. Hallelujah. And you don't need to leave this world without Jesus. And you're talking about waiting to do this and waiting to do that. But all that you have is right now. Yesterday is a page in the history of your life. And tomorrow is not promised. All that you have is right now. Tell the people next to you on both sides, all you have is right now. Hallelujah. And with that in mind, you need to get up and come to Jesus. God bless you, young people. Come on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Six. That's still another one. That's right, young man. Come on. Hallelujah. God bless you, my brother. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let that one through also. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Just before I step down and shake hands with you and you go with these elders, I want to just breathe a word of prayer. Now, God, our Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for these souls that you have brought to the bleeding side of Calvary. Thank you, Lord, that on this day, your spirit is present to make a difference. We rebuke the hand of the enemy, and we command him to take his hands off, because no longer does he have any power over any one of these that stand here. We break the power of Satan. We command him to take his hands off, that these might be delivered and set free. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Every one of you that's come, just lift up your hands and tell the Lord yes. Satan don't want you to live for the Lord, but the Lord says, are you ready to live for me? Tell him yes, Lord. Are you willing to give him your life? Tell him yes, Lord. From this day forward, will you let him be Lord in your life? Tell him yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Listen, I'm just going to shake hands with you. You're going to follow these worship coordinators, Elder Freeman and Elder Thompson. God bless you. Father, these preachers here, God bless you. 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 God bless you.